I want to read a scripture only because it defines who we are as a church, who I am as a pastor, where what I think our church represents in the day in which we're living. In Amos, the prophet Amos wrote these words. He said, "Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land. Not a famine for bread or a thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord. People will stagger from sea to sea and from north even to the east. They will go to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, but they will not find it." I feel like that's a prophetic word for us today, that if we look out on the landscape of the church, all around us, the church, there is a famine for the word of God. There is what was predicted. And so when we look at the word of God today, I just want us to remember that the word of God is the basis for our whole being, our whole life, our whole future. It is the source of truth. The word of God is the revelation of God for us. So, first of all, the title of the sermon is kind of telling. It's "Just As I Am and Who I Am Becoming." Because I think that both of those are true. Both of those need to be emphasized. And so the beginning of the sermon, I'm going to be talking about just as I am and the marvelous things that God has done for people, for sinners. And I hope in the first part of this sermon that you will just absolutely be refreshed and reminded of what God has done for you. It's really important. We have to always remember this. So, the first thing I want to say, and you can jot these broad notes down if you want to, but the first thing is that the believer in Christ is saved from the penalty of sin, all of it. The believer is saved, is rescued from the penalty of sin. The word penalty, I just looked it up, and it means the punishment imposed for a violation of law. It's what you get when you've been caught speeding down I-5 or a school zone or whatever. So the penalty would be the punishment imposed for a violation of a law. It could be a parking ticket, it could be a speeding ticket, it could be something worse or less. Another way of looking at it is a sum established by a contract to be forfeited in lieu of actual damages in the event of a breach of contract. So the penalty would be if you break your contract, you break your word, the penalty would be like if you promised to pay your credit cards. You ever do that? You ever charge things on credit cards? Maybe not this group. Maybe we've had too much Dave Ramsey in our life, but so if you say, "I'm gonna charge this to my credit card," and then it comes due and you don't pay it, you breached the contract that you made with them, guess what they do? Then they up your interest to 27% or worse, and there are penalties that are assessed to you. It can be the disadvantage or painful consequences resulting from an action or a condition. A penalty is a punishment, a handicap, or a loss of advantage, or it could be described as suffering in person or in property. So the Bible tells us, and we're going to look at a little bit here, that believers are saved from the penalty of sin. No penalty. No judgment. No judgment for sin for the believer. Does that make you happy? I hope so. Come on. Yeah. No judgment, no penalty, no guilty. You will pay a penalty. You will pay a fine. You will go, you know, it's the believer has been saved from the penalty of sin. In fact, Lewis Berry Chafer wrote these words when he was talking about our salvation. He said, salvation represents the whole work of God by which he rescues man from the eternal ruin and doom of sin and bestows on him the riches of his grace, including eternal life now and eternal glory in heaven. Amen. It is in every aspect a work of God in behalf of man and is in no sense a work of man in behalf of God. Amen. I tell you, that should take a big load off of the shoulders of those who are attempting to earn, to work, to merit the favor of God. Because, let me say it again, salvation represents the whole work of God by which he rescues man from the eternal ruin, from the eternal penalty and doom of sin, and bestows on him the riches of his grace, including eternal life now and eternal glory in heaven. It is in every aspect a work of God in behalf of man, and in no sense a work of man in behalf of God. I know I had to do that twice because it was so rich, right? So, when it comes to God, it doesn't matter who commits an act of sin. It doesn't matter if you are a Christian and you sin, and it doesn't matter if you're an unbeliever and you sin. I don't mean it doesn't matter, but in God's sight, both, all of it is equally shameful. It makes no difference who commits a sin. A heathen in a country that doesn't have the Word of God, or someone who we might call a civilized man, doesn't matter. Of course, Luke 12, 47 and 48 speaks sort of on the issue of whether a person would get a few stripes or a lot of stripes, you know, lashes, punishment for sin, doesn't matter. But any sin in itself is unburying sinful because it outrages the holiness of God. So we just have to understand the good news is good news because our sin is bad news and our sin offends God. And something that is offensive to God has to be dealt with. To offend or to outrage something means to offend grossly against the standards of decency or morality. Outrage, to outrage means to commit an outrage on, to produce anger or resentment. So our sin affects God. Our neighbor's sin affects God. The people in the courthouse, in the jail, their sin offends God. I just heard this morning, I was listening to Chuck Swindoll, and he was speaking to some seminary students at Dallas, two or three years ago, and he was preaching, and this great big guy, great big man, came up. He had tattoos. He's a great big guy, and he walked up to Chuck Swindoll, and he said, I don't know what he said. I'm just kind of remembering kind of the conversation, but he said, I just want to give you a hug. And Chuck Swindoll was not sure what was coming. He was a great big guy. And he just put his arms around him and almost squeezed the life out of him. And he says, I just want you to know I've been a bad man in my life. I've done a lot of bad things. And he said, and I just want to thank you because I've been in solitary confinement for years. And it was your preaching of the word of God that brought me through all of that. And then he wanted to hug him again. It's such a great story because the word of God, the truth of God transforms lives. People don't transform lives. The Spirit of God, using the Word of God, transforms lives. And he said, your daily, everyday radio broadcast, teaching, expositing the Word of God is what changed my life. It was just such a great story. And he would agree that my sin outraged the holiness of God. And here's the truth about this. I'm going to tie this together in just a minute. You'll get it. You'll get there. But sin can be cured only on the ground of the shed blood of the Son of God. There is no other cure for sin. There's no other cure for sin in our culture, in our families, in our personal lives. There is no other cure. Sin can be cured only on the ground of the shed blood of the Son of God. In the Old Testament, in the old order, as we read the Old Testament, it was true for them. It was true for those who anticipated the death of Christ by animal sacrifices. In the Old Testament, the many, Leviticus chapter 4, Leviticus chapter 5, Leviticus chapter 6, all of it had to do with animal sacrifices which anticipated the final sacrifice of Christ on the cross. And so when we read, you don't have to turn there. You could spend all afternoon, and I might keep you awake. I don't know. Leviticus chapter 4, 5, and 6. But this was the book, the manual for the priests in the Old Testament, in the Old Order. And for example, it says, then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, if a person sins unintentionally, even unintentional sin in the old order, in any of the things which the Lord has commanded not to be done, and commits any of them, if the anointed priest sins so as to bring guilt on the people, let him offer to the Lord a bull without defect as a sin offering for the sin he has committed. He shall bring the bull to the doorway of the tent of meeting before the Lord, and he shall lay his hand on the head of the bull and slay the bull before the Lord. Then the anointed priest is to take some of the blood of the bull and bring it to the tent of meeting. If you were a Jewish worshiper in the old order, the old covenant, it was a bloody place to go to the temple. It just was. We don't fully get that. We're so clean and neat. We vacuum. Brian takes care of the place. The temple was a bloody place. And so then the anointed priest is to take some of the blood of the bull and bring it to the tent of meeting, and the priest shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle some of the blood seven times before the Lord in front of the veil of the sanctuary. And then the priest shall also put some of the blood on the horns of the altar of fragrant incense, which is before the Lord in the tent of meeting. And the blood of the bull shall be shall pour out at the base of the altar of the burnt offering, which is at the doorway of the tent of meeting. So all of those sacrifices anticipated the death of Christ on the cross. They were all pictures. They were real. They really did offer to the worshipers a covering for sin, an atonement for sin, but it was all in the anticipation of Christ coming in the new order, in the after the cross. So it was only after the priest, had offered the atoning blood sacrifice, which anticipated the death of Christ, that the sinner was forgiven. It was only after the priest had offered the atoning blood sacrifice, which anticipated the death of Christ, that the sinner was forgiven. So what about after Christ? What about after Christ Jesus came? Well, I'm just going to have you turn with me to a couple verses in the New Testament. Let's just look at Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. Here's what the Apostle Paul taught about this atoning sacrifice of Christ, the blood sacrifice that Jesus offered. Colossians 1:13 says, "For he rescued us." If you're a believer in Christ, you have been rescued. You didn't even know you needed to be rescued, but you have been rescued. He rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. You've been rescued from the domain, from the kingdom of darkness, from Satan's kingdom, from the darkness of God's enemy, and you have been transferred into the kingdom, the rule of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, or we have been purchased, the forgiveness of our sins. Isn't that great? Okay, and Ephesians 1:7. All right. In him, when we believe in him, we have redemption through his what? Through his blood. Through his blood. Not through church membership, not through giving a lot of money, but in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of the things that outrage the holiness of God. The forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Let me read on a little bit more from Dr. Chafer. He says, "The substitutionary work of Christ upon the cross is infinitely perfect in its sufficiency. Therefore, the sinner who trusts in Christ not only is forgiven, but he is even justified forever." Man. Declared righteous in the sight of God forever. That is so amazing. Romans chapter 3 and verse 24. Romans 3. And verse 24. Being justified as a what? As a what? As a what? A gift. Say it loudly. A gift. Being justified as a gift. Being justified as a gift. By his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. So this substitutionary work of Christ upon the cross is infinitely perfect in its sufficiency. It's sufficient. The cross work of Christ is sufficient for you. It's sufficient for that big guy who got released from solitary confinement in prison. It was sufficient for me. It's sufficient for you. God has never, listen to this, God has never treated sin lightly. Never. He has never treated sin lightly. He has never said, oh, it's okay. It's not that big of a deal. It is always a big deal with him. He has never treated sin lightly. Forgiveness may impose no burden on the sinner. Listen, there's no burden on the sinner for forgiveness. Forgiveness may impose no burden on the sinner, but he is forgiven and justified only because the undiminished divine penalty, listen to that, the undiminished divine penalty has been borne by Christ. We just need to understand that. This is nothing to do with you, nothing to do with your works, nothing to do with your deserving it, nothing to do with you at all. It is a work of God based solely on the truth that Jesus bore the undiminished divine penalty for sin. That's it. You didn't have anything to do with it. You didn't deserve it. You didn't earn it. You can't earn it. So let's look a little bit further at 1 Peter chapter 2, just to underline this in our minds. Hebrews, James, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 24. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might, he did this so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you, what? Were healed. If you are a believer in Christ, then the Bible teaches that you have been healed of sin. You have been forgiven. You have been redeemed. You have been justified. It's a past finished work of God on behalf of the believing sinner. One more. 1 Peter 3:18. 1 Peter 3:18. For Christ also died for sins. Once for whom? For all. Once for all. The just. Not the one who came out of prison because of the bad things that he had done, but the one who was just, the one who was righteous, the one who was sinless, the one who was perfect, the just one, for, in the place of, the unjust one, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Man, there's such rich truth, and we just need to remember it and remember it and enjoy it. Can you enjoy that today? Can you? Can you love Christ for what he's done for you? Can you? Can you thank him? Can you rejoice in his wonderful work of salvation for you? I hope so. So my question for each one in this room, because we never know, what hope do you have for eternal life? Where do you stand with Christ? Have you put your faith, have you trusted fully in the finished work of Christ for you? That's a really important question. There are only two options in life. We either are believers or we are unbelievers. We are either saved or we are lost. There's only two sides of that fence, and there are only two outcomes to our life, so that when we go to the cemetery in our casket or in our urn or whatever, everything has been determined. There is only heaven or there is hell. One destiny or another. So, we were up at my sister's, we went to Whidbey Island and camped for three days, and then we drove up to Oak Harbor, Coopville, where my sister lives, and we had a great time. We just really enjoyed it, and we haven't really been together with them since my mom died over 2 years ago. And so then one of the days we drove out to the cemetery and sat around with my mom and dad for a long time in the sun on Whidbey Island, just visited, remembered my dad, my mom, and enjoyed visiting with Mark and Mary. And we just had a really great time. I'm really glad we got to do that. We got to bring some flowers from Amy up there and put them on the grave, and it was just a really, really special day. And then in the evenings, we would come home and have dinner together, and then we sat around. And we listened to a lot of music together. I mean, we did watch a little baseball. I'm being honest. But we sat around and listened to music and songs. And a lot of it was Bill Gaither and that whole group of amazing vocalists and singers. And as we were talking to my sister and her husband, they were funeral directors for all of their career. And I wonder sometimes how many families came dragging themselves into the funeral home with grief and with burdens, and in many cases in search of hope. And my sister doesn't tell me much. It's just that if you're in the funeral business, you see a lot of things that are very, very, very difficult. I think we should be very, very kind to the people that work at Cattermole and other funeral homes for what they go through. And I'm not really sure the whole context of my sister in wanting this song, but this was the song that she once played at her funeral someday. When we were sitting looking at my dad and my mom's graves, right next to my mom is someday going to be my sister. She told me we bought that plot. I'm going to be right next to mom, and Mark is going to be right there. And it's a beautiful cemetery. But she said, when I have a service, this is the song that I want to sing. And I just want us to know that heaven, because of what Christ did, heaven awaits us. Amen. It's going to be different. It's going to be amazing. And so, whether you like this type of music or not, this man is, in my judgment, one of the greatest Christian voices in our world today. And this was recorded about 9 years ago. They've recorded it since then. But I'm going to ask you guys to play it, and you guys just to remember Christ died in my place so that I could be saved from my sin and someday enjoy the glory of heaven.
It's not a dream. God will make
We will live in the light of the risen Lamb someday. So, you were born one day. I know you all were. Your mom was there. I don't know if they let your dad in back then. But you were born physically. And then if you're a believer in Christ, some time went by and sometime you put your trust in Christ. You have to do that to be born again. You have to be twice born. You're born physically, but you're also born separated from God because of sin, because of our sinfulness, because we're part of Adam's race. So we need to be saved. We need to be redeemed through faith in Christ. But I don't know when you were saved. Anybody want to tell us how many years ago that was for you? Just tell me if you can, if you feel okay about that. 64?
1992.
You're not going to do the math? Pardon?
June of 61.
All right. Great. Yes, Donna? 75 years ago. Yeah. Amazing. You got to have a birth date. That's all I can say. You have to have a second birth date to get to heaven. You have to trust Christ. So, but after you're saved, I don't know if I should ask you this, Donna. How long has it been since you were saved? Then we could really figure out how old you are.
I'm not ashamed.
You're not ashamed. Okay, so how long has it been since you were... Well, no, that was 75 years ago. Okay, that's what I needed to know. Yeah. So, and we don't know, none of us know, after we come to Christ, how much time we have on the earth, right? None of us know that. We took our grandson to Vancouver yesterday, and both ways, coming and going down and coming back, there were pretty big wrecks on I-5. And we just never know. We don't know how long we have. And so, there is this period of time that we have on earth for us to live for God, to love out of gratitude for what God has done. Literally, to live in a way that pleases Him. So we are born physically, but separated from God. Sometime we need to be born again by the Spirit of God. And then we have this period of time as God allows for us to live on the earth until our death, until He takes us to heaven. So what happens in the meantime is pretty important to God. The way you're living right now is very important to God. You're already going to get to experience heaven. You're already going to be able to enter heaven's gates through the blood sacrifice of Christ. But how you live is going to, what we do with the life that God has given us is pretty important to God as well. So, we have, not only are we saved from the penalty of sin, but we can be saved from the power of sin. Mm-hmm. And that's where you and I struggle right now. We struggle with sin. How much do we struggle? Well, just think about all the words that come out of our mouth in the last week. How did you guys do? One of the verses we're learning is, let no unwholesome word proceed out of your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification, according to the need of the moment, so that it may give grace to those who hear, so that it will give grace to those who hear. Our teacher on Wednesdays was talking about a man who worked at the church when they were making a big concrete pour at their church, and he was a little salty. And I don't know if he was saved or not, but I just know that the chute of the concrete truck swung around and hit him in the head. And he let fly with a few choice words. And then he turned around and saw Pastor D standing there. And he was feeling pretty embarrassed about the whole thing. And sometime later, because he survived that, he asked Pastor D if he would, he says, I've been smoking 2 packs of cigarettes for a long time, and I'm wondering if you can help me quit, because I really can't. And Pastor D, in his wisdom, honestly, this is the most wise thing, the profound thing that I heard in a long time. He said, well, let me tell you something. He said, I think that you need to trust God with your tongue. And he says, if you, by the Spirit of God, can have self-control over what comes out of your mouth, I'm pretty sure quitting smoking is going to be pretty easy. I never thought about that in that way before, honestly, but I read in the book of James, chapter 3, it says, let not many of you become teachers, my brethren, knowing that as such we will incur a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to bridle the whole body as well. Now, if we put the bits into the horses' mouths so that they will obey us, we direct their entire body as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so great and driven by strong winds, are still directed by a very small rudder wherever the inclination of the pilot desires. So also the tongue is a small part of the body, and yet it boasts of great things. See how great a forest is set aflame by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, the very world of iniquity. The tongue is set among our members as that which defiles the entire body and sets on fire the course of our life and is set on fire by hell. For every species of beasts and birds, of reptiles and creatures of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by the human race, but no one can tame the tongue. So do you think that God is interested in what we say, how we talk to people? Have you ever said stuff and said, man, where did that come from? Why did I say that? You know? And it's really hard to control this little thing called the tongue. But it's part of the process that we go through as believers in Christ. Every day we are struggling to let edifying words come out of our mouth, to let good speech come out of our mouth, to build up other people, to not slander. There's a verse we're memorizing right now. It says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and slander and clamor be put away from you, along with all malice. Let me think here. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven us. It says, let all the things that come out of our mouth, the clamor, the bitterness, the slander, the things that we say with our mouths. And that's just to say that one of the things that God wants to do with you and me is to save us from the power of sin. And that takes our working together with God. James just said, man, everything I hear, people all around me, coming out of their mouth is stuff that needs to be under control. And so I want to tell you this. Here's a couple thoughts for us. Only Christians may be delivered from sin. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. Only Christians may be delivered from sin by God. You might say, well, I know non-Christians that are delivered from sin. Not by God. Not in the way that God wants to deliver his people. Only Christians may be delivered from sin. This is God's gracious provision for those whom he has already saved from the guilt and penalty of sin. Though believers are saved, though believers are safe in Christ, there's two places that we are sure about sin in the life of the Christian. Christians still have the disposition to sin, and Christians do sin. If I were to play back a tape recording of what came out of your mouth this week, would that convict you? It would convict me. And so Christians still have the disposition to sin, and Christians do sin, but that should not cause us to doubt our faith in Christ. Our sin should not cause us to doubt our salvation. Christians should not yield to the practice of sin. Christians should, here it is, Christians should learn God's gracious provisions for deliverance. The most important theme to be mastered by the human mind is the divine plan whereby a Christian may live to the glory of God. I think the big question this morning is, how do we live to the glory of God? How do I live to the glory of God? How do I please God? How do I take advantage of his resources and be changed? And not talk the way I used to talk, and not do what I used to do. That's a really big question. The most important theme to be mastered by the human mind is the divine plan, God's plan, whereby a Christian may live to the glory of God. So then we come to the problem of sin in the life of the believer. The problem of sin in the life of the believer. And Peter and many other passages in the scripture tell us that God's Spirit and his word provide everything that is essential to godly living. The Spirit of God, God coming to dwell in the believer. That is an amazing divine resource that God has given us. God comes to live in us through the Spirit of God. Jesus said, if I don't go away, the Spirit of God will not come, but he comes to indwell the believer. That is our resource. That's what we have. That's the power source for change in our life. Right? Yeah. And we have the Word of God. And I went on to think about this a little further, and I'm thinking, and we have God's people. God wants believers who have permission to come alongside another believer and to exhort and encourage and build them up. And We need to focus on God's prophetic promises. Someone wrote, you can never break God's promises by leaning on them. I like that. You can never break God's promises by leaning on them. God is faithful to his promises. So we need to be deeply rooted in the prophetic promises of God's word. And I think there's one more motivating factor, and that is looking for the return of Christ. I think if we want to be motivated to live pleasing to God, we must understand that he's going to come back. He's coming back. And 2 Corinthians 5:10 says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. We're going to have a day of accounting before the Lord. Not for sin. Not for sin. But God is going to say, man, you lived in a way by the power of the Spirit of God that was so pleasing to me. I want to reward you for that. I noticed it. I knew about it. I marked your suffering for Christ. I marked your work for the kingdom. I worked. I noticed it all, and I want to reward you. Here's another statement. Christians become partakers of God's very nature by faith in his promises. In our day, as in Peter's day, many people are interested in becoming partakers of the divine nature. We all want to be God. But that's not how it works. God comes to live within us, and by the power of the Spirit and by our reliance upon him, we can be partakers or sharers, or we can become more like God, more like Christ. We will not become gods. Let me make that clear. So when God saved us by faith in his promises, he indwelt us, and we therefore possess the nature of God within us in that sense. God lives within us. God's Spirit in us manifests the likeness of God in Christ through us. Now, my last point. God saves people from the penalty of sin. God saves people from the power of sin. And here's the last one. God saves us to participate in the greatest contest of your life. It's really hard to communicate over the internet when the people you're communicating with are in Germany. But this morning at 12:30 a.m., my daughter-in-law, Ainsley, participated in the Berlin Marathon. So she and Andrew flew over there. They're there for about a week, and there were 45,000 entrants in that race. It's an amazing race. And we've watched Ainsley go through the birth of her kids and the effects that that had on her body and surgeries as a result of that. And now she has been training and training. There it is. That's called the Tiergarten. It is like the zoo, the Tiergarten in Berlin. And that's a picture of 45,000 runners who are about to embark on a great crusade all the way through the city of Berlin. And so we got on last night at about 12, and you can get an app on your phone and track them. And we tracked her for about, well, I think I tracked her. Somebody else did not track her, but I did. She said, wake me up if you figure it out. So I tracked her for a few minutes till she got about 5 kilometers down the road. I just want to say, I don't know if these figures are completely accurate, because there's a little bit of deciding your ranking with your age group and whether you're with women or men. But so don't quote me on this, but what Andrew said about Ainsley is that she came in like 700 and some place out of 45,000 runnels. So it was pretty amazing. And I think we have a picture of her up there. Maybe. Nope. Okay. Well, you don't get to see a picture of Ainsley, but someday she'll come up and you can meet her. But yeah, so yeah, they've been in Berlin and they're going to be there for a few more days, and it's pretty great. And it's, you don't just decide on a whim to fly to Berlin and run in a marathon. It takes a lot of training and preparation. She's been doing that for a long time, and it is a contest. It is an athletic contest. Paul is one who, probably from his visits to Corinth, used the imagery of a contest, of a race. You know, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Therefore, run in such a way that you may win. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. I run in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave. Paul said this, so that after I have preached to others, I will not be disqualified. 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27. And Paul used the imagery of a race. And there's no racing, there's no training, there's nothing we can do to earn salvation. But in the time between our salvation and when we go to heaven, we are in a contest of faith. We are in the arena. We are running a race for the glory of God. And even that is by faith. Even that is by trusting God, by believing in God, not in our own strength, but I can't do these things without you, without the Spirit of God empowering me. But we are in a contest, and sometimes the contest costs us our life. I sat with my two grandkids this week, and we watched a documentary and a little cartoon about the life of Jim Elliot, a missionary, who said, he is no fool, who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. And Jim Elliot gave his life in that contest so that the Alka Indians could hear about Christ. So we are in a contest. You are in a contest. It's not about just filling slots and having church programs going. We are in a contest, a spiritual contest that requires discipline and it requires training. And it requires concentration. One day, in heaven, you will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. It's not just a doctrine of Scripture. You will appear there. And God will sift through your life and how you have been a steward of what God has given you and how you have served him and how you have pleased him. And it is never about punishment, ever. God is not going to ever punish his kids, but he has for some reason chosen to reward us for faithful service to him. So, here's a few thoughts as we close. God wants your appearance in heaven to be the best moment of your life. He does not want you to come in with your tail between your legs. He wants you to come into heaven and appear before him. And like the Apostle Paul, the writer of Hebrews, pictured the life of faith. It's the life of faith as an athletic contest. He reminds us that the grandstands of heaven are packed. The crowds are watching and the pressure is on. Then he gives believers invaluable pointers for winning our race. And I could go a long time. I'm just going to give you the points. Number one, we need to lay aside everything that hinders you and the sin that entangles. If you're a racer, if you're a runner, in Corinth, the runners ran buck naked. Just got to tell you, they really took that serious. They laid everything aside that hindered them. And the writer of Hebrews says, lay aside everything that hinders you and the sin that entangles. So serious athletes know that many things can slow them down and rule out their chances of winning. Heavy clothing, poor eating, and sleeping routines, and distractions or snares of any kind in the disciples' race, nothing will slow you down, trip you up, and cause you to miss the prize like sin will. It's the problem of sin in our life. It's been forgiven, but sin trips us up and slows us down and keeps us from running for the prize. So lay it aside today by confessing it to Jesus. Number two, run with perseverance the race that is set before you. Your race is different than someone else's race. The race, the life that God has laid before you, run it with perseverance. On the walls of the Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs is a motto: persistence is an invisible living strategy in all champions. Isn't that great? Persistence is an invisible living strategy in all champions. We build our endurance when we do the right thing over and over and over and over again. We build endurance by doing the right things over and over again. And the last thing is fix our eyes on Jesus. Any athlete will tell you that where you fix your eyes is crucial. When Sarah Hughes turns herself into a spinning human top, she was a figure skater, keeps her balance by focusing her eyes on exactly the same spot with each turn. In the same way, Jesus is the mark that we fix our eyes on. He is our source of help, and he is the center of our reason for running. Jude wrote that Jesus is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. The bottom line is, I hope you are running with this in mind. Matthew 25:21 says, his master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the what?
Rest.
Joy.
Or the joy of your master. Heaven is going to be full of joy. Father, thank you for heaven and the hope that we have of meeting you in glory based on the finished, wonderful work of Christ. The blood sacrifice of Christ for us. And Lord, as we struggle in this life with sin, I just pray that we would persist and persevere and hold on to you, Jesus, to keep our eyes focused upon you. And I pray that you would help us this week to live in a way that brings you glory, that brings you honor. Lord, if we need to control what comes out of our mouth, if our kids need to learn that, our grandkids, I pray that they would learn that principle of mastering our speech. And Lord, thank you that there's a finish line. Thank you that there's a day when we will rest from our labors and we will be with you in heaven and probably take whatever rewards you give us and throw them down at your feet. So Lord, I know heaven is going to be about Christ, the Savior, and we're looking forward to seeing him one day. Lord, thank you for your people. Thank you for your church. Thank you for this time together today. In Christ's name, and all of God's people said,
Amen. Amen.